Hey everyone, this is Zach with 8020 Media, here today with a video on signs and symptoms of a faulty intercooler. Intercoolers are essential components on forced induction engines that help improve performance and reliability on turbocharged or supercharged engines. Without an intercooler on the engine, intake air temperatures, or IAT for short, will get extremely hot and begin sapping performance from the engine. And on top of that, hotter air also makes the engine more prone to knock and detonation. That's really the role that an intercooler plays, is to cool the charge air, help maximize performance, help deliver consistent performance, and also improve reliability by reducing the chance of engine knock or other serious issues. When talking about signs and symptoms of a faulty intercooler, it is important to lay out the basics of a couple different intercooler designs. So the two main designs for intercoolers on modern turbocharged or supercharged engines are air-to-air or air-to-water intercooler systems. So air-to-air intercoolers relies on outside ambient air temperatures to cool the charge air after it's passed through the turbo or supercharger. So air-to-air intercoolers are often front or side-mounted on the vehicle. In a lot of cases, they are actually front-mounted. That's where the term comes from, front-mounted intercooler, or FMIC for short. So if you hear any mention of FMICs or front-mounted or side-mounted intercoolers, that is usually in reference to an air-to-air intercooler design. Now, air-to-water intercoolers, on the other hand, work much like the actual cooling system of the car in that it relies on a radiator, or also known as a heat exchanger, mounted at the front of the vehicle, which uses air from outside passing over the heat exchanger, which then cools the water and coolant mixture. And in turn, that water and coolant then travels through the intercooler, which has fins and blades, and the charge air passes through those fins and blades, where essentially the water and coolant mixture is what is responsible for actually cooling that charge air. Now, it was important to lay out this quick basic overview of the two different intercooler designs, because when we're talking about signs and symptoms of a faulty intercooler, the signs and symptoms can be very different depending on the type of intercooler system your vehicle uses. If it's an air-to-air system, typically problems are much more limited to a couple areas and will result in a few specific symptoms. And looking at the air-to-water intercooler, there are more room for failures just because it is relying on, again, basically a cooling system with the intercooler, a heat exchanger, fluids running throughout all of that, as well as a water pump. So air-to-water systems are a little more complicated and can have a wider range of issues and symptoms. But worry not, as I move through the signs and symptoms here, I'll point out a couple of the signs and symptoms that are more common for air-to-water versus air-to-air intercooler systems. So with that said, let's go ahead and jump in and actually discuss some of those symptoms of intercooler failure. Number one on the list, we have decreased engine performance. When your intercooler isn't functioning or functioning properly, there can be a very, very drastic drop in performance from this. Now, it does depend greatly on the vehicle in question, whether it's turbocharged, supercharged, how much boost you're actually running, and really how much the engine in general is relying on that forced induction. Ultimately, decreased power and performance might be challenging to notice unless you're really beating on the car, or in some cases, it can be incredibly severe. So the decrease in performance can be very drastic depending on the issue at hand and what goes wrong with the intercooler. Symptom number two, we have limp mode, low boost, and the check engine light. This ties into intake air temperatures getting too hot. As the engine picks up on that and reads those increasing temperatures, the engine is going to start pulling ignition timing, cutting boost, and taking other preventative and protective measures to keep the engine safe and healthy. And so oftentimes when it gets to that point, the engine will start throwing codes for that very reason. Hence things like limp mode, where potentially it's just kind of limping the car around to keep it safe. It may trigger the check engine light due to low boost or boost being under what would be normally targeted by the engine. As well, if you have a boost gauge or any way to monitor boost on the engine, you'll see that you're running into low boost when you do have an intercooler issue. Moving on to our third symptom, we have whining or whistling noises. Intercoolers a lot of the times don't actually fail on their own. A lot lot of the times it could be the plastic end tanks. So ultimately, a lot of the times what happens, especially when talking about an air-to-air intercooler, if the plastic end tanks of that intercooler break, that will actually lead to a boost leak. And as that charge air begins escaping from the crack piping or tubing or plastic end tank, that will result in those loud whining or hissing noises as that highly pressurized air escapes. Depending on the size of the boost leak, it can be pretty loud when you hear that whistling and whining noise. So if you're hearing anything like that, that might indicate that you have a boost leak. And again, that could be caused by a number of different things, whether that be the plastic end tanks on an air-to-air intercooler, or even if you have plastic end tanks on an air-to-water intercooler, it's possible that that could crack as well. Moving on to symptom number 4, we have smoke from the exhaust or coolant leaks. With this issue, we're focusing on just air-to-water intercoolers because it is, again, a much more complex and complicated design. So ultimately, there are a couple different things that can happen with these air-to-water intercooler systems. If you run into an issue with the intercooler specifically, it's possibly the intercooler could run into an internal crack or issues around the fins, which would ultimately allow coolant to leak into the intercooler, where it would eventually be pulled through the intake tract into the cylinders and burn off during combustion. That will lead to smoke coming out of the exhaust. So if you're noticing that, it could potentially be a sign and symptom that your intercooler is having internal issues and allowing coolant to enter the engine. And then on the other hand, when it comes to visible coolant leaks or puddles of coolant, again, that could be a number of things, whether it be the cracked heat exchanger, the intercooler leaking externally, or any of the coolant hoses or water pump that are powering the cooling system for the air-to-water intercooler. Now, it does depend on the design of the car and the engine. However, a lot of systems that do use an air-to-water intercooler actually utilize an entire secondary cooling system. I know this is something BMW does on a lot of their newer models with the air-to-water intercoolers. So again, you have the water pump, coolant hoses, heat exchanger, and intercooler itself. And any one of those could potentially run into issues that could begin leaking coolant and leading to puddles and visible coolant leaks underneath the vehicle. So ultimately, that wraps up the most common signs and symptoms of intercooler issues. Now, to quickly discuss a few of the most common causes of intercooler problems, the intercooler itself, or the big core of the intercooler, rarely runs into issues or fails. Instead, as I mentioned, a lot of the times it's going to really boil down to things like boost leaks. On air-to-air intercoolers, you have the boost pipes or charge pipes connected to both ends of the intercooler and potentially plastic end tanks on the intercooler. And those are common areas to run into faults, whether that be a cracked charge pipe, cracked end tank, or simply a connection or something that has popped loose. And so a lot of the times the biggest issue with air-to-air intercoolers is the potential for boost leaks. Now, air-to-water intercoolers may also run into boost leaks. However, on these systems, it's really a lot more common to run into problems with the cooling system itself. So looking for things like coolant leaks or cracked coolant hoses, issues with the heat exchanger, so on and so forth, are typically going to be the more common problems, again, rather than the actual intercooler itself. Anyway, guys, that wraps up our video for today. If you appreciated the content, please hit that like button, subscribe to the channel, and stay tuned for more in the future. Thanks, everyone.